I want to welcome you all to this special program that's being sponsored by the Facing History and Ourselves National Foundation and by the National Association for Armenian Studies and Research. This happens coincidentally that this is the 10th anniversary of the Facing History Foundation and the 30th anniversary of NASA. And we are very happy to be able to join forces in order to put on this program and have with us Professor Richard Ovanisyan from the University of California at Los Angeles in order to talk to us about teaching about the genocide. I would just like to take a couple minutes of your time and give you a little historical background as to how we got to this point. The Facing History and Ourselves Foundation was founded originally as a program in the Buckline Public Schools funded by a federal grant in order to develop a curriculum for the teaching of the Holocaust. And this started 10 years ago. And about 2 years or 3 years down the line, the program writers, as it were, the directors of the program, Margot Strom and Bill Parsons, became aware of the fact that you really cannot study the Holocaust without going back before the time of the Holocaust and see what happened in the case of previous genocides, and the most notable one in the beginning of the century, early part of the century, was of course the Armenian genocide. Once they became aware of this, then the next task was find material about the Armenian genocide, to find information about it so it could be incorporated in the curriculum that they were preparing. And at that point, they were put in touch with us, NASA, and that was about 7 or 8 years ago. When we heard what they were doing and when they saw what we had as resources, the marriage was a very quick one between the two organizations, and so far as cooperating together to develop a curriculum on the Armenian genocide. We were very happy to adopt this project, and during the course of the time from then until now, NASA has contributed over $30,000 towards the preparation of this segment of the curriculum, the Armenian genocide segment of the curriculum. We have been continuing our role of assistance and backup and participation in the Facing History activities. The Facing History organization has gone through several transformations, the most notable one of which is that now it is a national foundation. It has nothing to do with the Brookline Public Schools other than the fact that it has space in one of the Brookline schools. It has become a nationwide force. It has made countless numbers of people aware of the necessity to teach about the Holocaust and about the Armenian genocide. And the numbers that have been achieved in this span of time are staggering. In the period of time that the Facing History organization has been in existence, over 400 school systems are now involved in the teaching of the Holocaust and Armenian genocide curriculum. Some in a small way, others in a very large way, depending on the number of hours they set aside, a number of programs in which they have it a part of. Over 26,000 teachers have been trained to teach this curriculum. Over 5,000 non-educators have also participated in the workshops that the teachers have been at. And each year now, over 500,000 secondary school students, mainly on the junior high level, take the course in one form or another in these 400 school systems, as well as private schools, vocational high schools, technical institutes, universities and colleges, adult education programs, and interfaith programs. We are very happy over the development of this curriculum and the recognition of the importance of studying the Armenian genocide as a part of studying the Holocaust. And I would like to conclude my remark by quoting the very last speaker that we had at last year's conference on the Armenian genocide and human rights, which was held at Bentley College And the last speaker on the program of the 2.5-day conference was John Loftus. And let me quote from his closing remarks. The sacrifices of the victims will not be forgotten so long as one of us remembers the truth and teaches it to our children. The truth will prevail, and the final legacy of the 20th century will come in the 21st century when history books will all say, we remember the Armenians. On this note, I'd like to call upon Bill Parsons, who is the program director of the Facing History National Foundation, to give his remarks and introduce our distinguished guest, Professor Ovanesyan. Bill Parsons.
I have a very brief message. I really do. 10 years ago, when we began to look at this history, we would walk into workshops and we would say, who out of 300 teachers or 400 teachers or whatever we're dealing with, who here knows about the Armenian genocide? And we might get one or two hands would go up, and one of those two hands would be an Armenian teacher. Today we go into workshops, and many teachers know about the Armenian genocide, but they haven't studied it. What is going on today with the schools that are using Facing History is that teachers are teaching it in a much more substantive way than I think has ever been taught in the schools before. We have 1,500 school systems now nationally that if you walk into those classrooms, you would talk to students who are learning about the Armenian genocide. They may be learning about it for a day, or they may be learning about it for a week, or they may be learning about it for 1 hour, but at least they are starting to learn about the Armenian genocide. But it's been a difficult road, and I think one of the problems that we have faced is the denial issue, and that continually keeps coming up. Last year, in the town of Swampscott, we had the child who was whose parents were the Turkish consulate here in the Boston area, and he was going to take the Facing History course. And when the teacher started to talk about the Armenian genocide, the parents came in, the Turkish embassy came in, and they put enormous pressure on the teacher to stop teaching that piece of history. That piece of history was dropped in that town, and it was solely because three people from the Turkish consulate came in and approached that teacher. The town of Sharon on the south side also had severe pressure. The difference was that this was a school system we've been working with for about 5 years. And there was all kinds of support from the administrative level to the teachers and even to the parents and community who were supporting the program. And this time, when the pressure came on them to stop teaching the genocide, it was a very different response. And this time, the administrator simply said that this is a piece of history that we incorporated into the entire ninth grade in our program. But it's hard dealing with the issue, and it's very hard for a teacher who's out there all by themselves in a school system in Sandusky, Ohio, or Albuquerque, or wherever they are, and if they don't have the kind of support that this organization gives them, or that when Richard Hovhaniesian or the other scholars who talk about this history come and talk to the teachers, if they don't have that kind of support to legitimize the history and to say this is a legitimate piece of history that she taught in school, it's difficult. And you know a lot of what's going on in education today. There's a lot of education in the country today that is sliding away from dealing with anything controversial. In fact, I saw an article in the Globe a few months back, and a teacher was inquiring to foundations as to what she wanted to write a grant, an English grant. And she wanted to get a grant to write an English curriculum. So she wrote away to all the different textbook industries in this country and to publishers. And she said, what guidelines can you give me in terms of writing my curriculum? And they sent her back a list that said, don't do anything that's controversial. Don't do anything that has to do with racism, dehumanization, genocide. Don't do anything that has to do with drugs. Don't do anything that has to do with sex. Don't do anything that has to do with any literature that's controversial. And don't do anything from Kurt Vonnegut to the Red Badge of Courage. The list was a page long, published in Globe. The list was a page long of the do not teach. That doesn't leave you with a whole lot of interesting material to teach students. And
And what we've got is, we've got a lot of kids out there in the society. We work with many schools who are in inner city school systems who are really besieged by violence and vandalism and racism and the kind of hatred that's going on between groups of kids. When we went into one of the ones I talked about at the workshop today, in the Albuquerque Public Schools, and when the administrator walked in, she walked into the classroom, and across the back wall, all the Indian kids sat. And then there were two empty rows, and all the Hispanic kids sat. And then there were two empty rows, and all the Anglo white kids sat. And this was in about the middle of November when the administrator went in there. And at the end of the class period, she noticed that the Indian kids never said anything. They never spoke the entire class period. So she went up to the teacher, she asked the teacher, you know, how much English can the Indian kids speak? And she said, I don't know. And this is well into the school year. That classroom was a mirror of the kinds of issues that were going on in Albuquerque. You can tell in Albuquerque that the turf issues, the region, the part of the neighborhood that you walk into in terms of graffiti, you can tell at Boston English High School when you walk in there which stairwell you're on, whether you're on the German stairwell, or whether you're on the black stairwell, or whether you're on the Haitian stairwell, or whether you're on the Jamaican stairwell. You can tell exactly where you are because people are staking out their turf. And what is happening in education is there's not a lot of support out there for teachers not only to deal with controversial, difficult subject matter, but then to go give kids the tools to grow up in this society to deal with issues of violence, racism, and the kinds of things that are going on. So that's what this program really provides. What this program provides is an ongoing support to teachers throughout this country to not only grapple with just this particular history, but to take this history and to try and make meaning out of their lives and the kinds of things that are going on today in the world. And that's what we try to do. There was one teacher I was talking to the other day, and he said that he cannot get the kids to stop. They've been looking at the Armenian genocide, and then they were looking at the Holocaust and the issues of judgment. And he said kids daily come in with all kinds of articles on the Holocaust as a hoax, or the denial of the Armenian genocide in terms of some of the articles that the American Assembly, the Armenian Assembly sends out. And that's taking a piece of history and starting to try and make meaning out of what's currently going on in the world. Kids today in classrooms are talking about Libya. Kids in the classrooms today are talking about the refugee problem. When we were talking about the refugee problem with this history, students started talking about whether we should be letting the Haitian people into this country and the Jamaican people. And here were the issues of taking a look at the history and then trying to start making out of what's going on today. I really wish you were all up front here so I could really talk with you. And I'd really like to find out some of your questions throughout the evening. But I think what I'd like to do is to really pass on to Richard. Richard has been a mainstay. I really should say Professor Holinisi has been a mainstay of this organization. And he has walked into situation after situation and has literally turned around whole communities in terms of looking at this history. So he has supported us, and we greatly appreciate it. So, Richard.
Well, we will have nooses around our necks, I suppose, and continue to wear them. Good evening. I was hoping instead Bill did, I was hoping I could introduce him and have him do the presentation this evening. And indeed, what I'd like to do is not give a lecture at all, just want to talk and, with Bill as my partner. Talk a little bit about the Facing History program, what it is, the importance of it, and hopefully see a little film that is sometimes shown in the Facing History operations, and then have some discussion. I think it is relevant since the last conference I participated in, or the last workshop in Facing History, the featured workshop, Genocide Convention has finally been ratified in Washington, D.C. I'm not sure how significant the ratification of the Genocide Convention is. As you know, it is a convention that outlaws the crime of genocide and prescribes certain punishments for it. The record of the United Nations has not been very bright in the enforcement of measures to prevent mass murder and genocide since the organization was founded. But nonetheless, it seems to me after 30 years of struggle, the Genocide Convention in a watered-down form has finally been accepted. As we look at the Facing History and Ourselves curriculum, and this is, you've probably not seen the book, many of you may not have seen it, this is the book, Facing History and Ourselves, it's about 400 pages. It focuses, of course, largely on the Holocaust, World War II, on what happened to the Jews, and also Gypsies and other groups that were victimized in World War II. And it has a chapter of some 70 pages, a rather substantial chapter on the Armenians as well. As we look at this, and we look at the Genocide Convention, it's interesting that the two genocides, the Armenian and the Holocaust of World War II, one occurring in World War I and the other occurring in World War II, really had so much in common that in the Genocide Convention there are about five or six categories of crimes which constitute genocide. Any one of those perpetrated against a people is considered to be genocide. In the case of the Armenians and the Jews, I would say probably the two of this century, that the categorization fits all. That is, the Armenian and the Jewish classifications fit all of these, such as the attempt or the perpetration of the annihilation of a people in whole or part, as one definition of genocide, punishable by the convention. Secondly, the attempt to destroy or suppress the culture of a people. Thirdly, to try to prevent its procreation, that is, the childbearing capabilities of a people. Fourthly, of taking away the children and raising them as something else, that is, of cutting them off from their roots, and so forth. And it's interesting that these two occurrences of the 20th century, one happening in 1915, 1916, the other one in the 1940s, separated by one generation, really fit each one of these categories that falls under the United Nations definition of the crime of genocide. So there is certainly a linkage between the two. There's also a problem, as you know, of particularly among Holocaust scholars, of the problem of universality versus uniqueness. There are many Holocaust scholars that believe that the crime perpetrated against the Jewish people in World War II was so enormous, so great, and so different from all other mass killings that it was absolutely unique and should not be blended, should not be confused with other kinds of mass killings which may have been tragic but which did not have the same components. And there is a certain tug of war that goes on between scholars of Holocaust studies, those who believe that while each set of circumstances is unique, that one has to look for the more universal meaning and application of these lessons than simply focusing. Both sides have valid points. Both sides certainly have a right to the positions they hold. But the Facing History curriculum that we're dealing with really wants to take the Armenian Genocide and wants to take the Holocaust and use it not only to teach youngsters about what happened in the past, but also to teach them about themselves, their own attitudes about themselves, their attitudes about their neighbors of a different race, a different religion, a different nationality, and raises very important questions of judgment. It's very easy for us to sit there 50 years later, 70 years later, or 40 years later, and to condemn the indifference of A, B, or C. But if you bring that down to a personal level and say, let's assume that you are sitting in your home and someone is being attacked outside your home, what do you do? Do you shut the lights, pull down the shades, and hope it's going to go away, or do you try to help? There is a risk in trying to help. You yourself may be hurt. You may even become a victim when you try to intervene. Now, these are matters of judgment. These are matters of moral issues. And these are the kinds of questions that the Facing History curriculum tries to deal with. As I look at these two examples of genocide of the 20th century, there are again other parallels. It's interesting that if you talk to survivors of the Holocaust, many of them even didn't want to admit that they were survivors. There was a certain embarrassment, a certain need to suppress the fact that the genocide had taken place, or else that they had survived the genocide. And when I look back on the Armenian genocide as well, it took decades, really, for that genocide to come into sharp focus for the survivors. And when you look at some people who have studied Armenian literature, would even point to the fact that the Armenian writers after the genocide, most of them were killed, but the generation that survived after the genocide simply could not address that issue. It was so horrible, so terrible, that they couldn't deal with it. And what did they do? You would get a writer such as Gostan Zaryan, a very fine writer, who went back and recreated life before the genocide, an idyllic, a romanticized life of his Kharkiv, of his province, of the way his life was. And that, so they dealt with the idyllic, the pre-genocidal. They couldn't face head-on the horror and the terror of the genocide itself. Only in sort of oblique fashion, as Zaryan would say, as he talked about the good life and time, he would then come back with a phrase saying, "And then black snow fell upon the Armenians." I mean, what is the black snow? It's obviously, it's their death that is coming, and yet he doesn't even say directly what it is, but use these rather oblique references to it. And as I remember as growing up as a child, although I didn't grow up in an Armenian community, large Armenian community, I don't think there are very many Armenians today living who would say, "I don't know what April 24th is." That is, everybody knows in the Armenian community, whether they're activists or non-activists, that April 24th was the beginning of the genocide. It's a day that today is commemorated both with religious services, but also political activism, demonstrations, programs, and so forth. When I was growing up, as a the children of survivors, and my father had his entire family massacred and was the sole survivor of his family, I don't remember April 24th as a child. I don't remember commemorating April 24th, and I suspect even probably people in larger communities, they may have some vague little memory that maybe their grandmothers went to church or their mothers went to church appearance, but there was no sense of the outrage, the anger, the hostility, the hurt that seems to develop over time. And it's almost, funny is not the word, but indeed curious, interesting, that the generation, the children of the survivors, when they feel now, 50 years later, more intensely the suffering of their parents and their own suffering because of it than they did when they were children. Carefree children in Worcester or in Fresno or wherever they may have been. And so the impact of genocide grows, becomes intenser as the years go by and generations. And indeed, we come to what was referred to by Holocaust scholars as transgenerational trauma. The trauma of the survivor, even though the survivor may have been even silent most of his life about what had happened, the trauma of those mothers and fathers passing down to their children and their grandchildren in strange form sometimes, but at least in a very difficult situation they have dealing with it. For the Holocaust survivors, it was the same. For 30 or 40 years, the world wanted to forget. They wanted to forget, just as the Armenian survivors, for the most part, simply wanted to forget, create new lives, go on with their lives. When obviously the genocide comes up in conversation and other things, but let us not dwell upon it. And so it was with Holocaust survivors in this country and other countries, where they didn't want to dwell upon it. It was too ugly, it was too bad, and also other people didn't want to hear about it. Now, it took the Holocaust survivors and what happened in World War II certainly at least about 20 years, 25 years, really to start coming back. And it's only within the last few years that there is a acceptability of the Holocaust. Even now, the acceptability that the Holocaust has received is not true in the Armenian case. The Armenian case has much less acceptability and awareness in the public. That is, once again, I don't think you can find very many people in the United States who do not have at least a vague idea of what the Holocaust was. They may not know the details, they may not even like to hear about it, but if you talk to someone in any state in this union, I suspect that they're going to be able to say, yes, Holocaust or Hitler, Jews, the connection is made. But it's not true, certainly, in the Armenians, despite the fact that the Armenian genocide occurred a generation before, despite the fact that there was probably more publicity about the Armenian genocide in this country in 1915 than there was about the Holocaust when the Holocaust was taking place in this country. After all, the Armenians were Christians and victims, and there was a great American tradition of extending assistance to the Christian Armenians in the past, so that that was something. And every Sunday school, starting from Harvard Square on, they collected nickels and dimes for the starving Armenians, that is, for the widows and the orphans who were left. So there was a great deal of recognition at the time. But it vanished within one generation. Memory vanished. The sense of history in this country is not very deep. It's interesting. Some people would do perhaps a study of what is a sense of history in America. America seems to be so new and so removed from Europe and the old world that the sense of history does not seem to linger on in the way it does in other parts of the world. Acceptability of the Holocaust has a lot of reasons. Foremost of which, of course, I think was the creation of the State of Israel. The pride that the State of Israel spread throughout Jewish communities around the world, the resources of the Jewish world, the fact that in Israel they established centers for the study of the history of the Jewish people and were able to give, as I say, a sense of direction, a sense of pride to Jewish communities around the world, which themselves then began to focus. But more importantly, the mood was becoming more acceptable to the study and knowledge of the Holocaust. There was enough influence within the general media, that is the film industry, the television industry, and the publishing industry, so that hundreds if not thousands of books on the Holocaust by survivors and others have been published. And as you know, there are certainly by now hundreds of television and movie productions that deal with one or another aspect of the Jewish Holocaust. Not so in the Armenian case. And the answer, or the reason, one of the main reasons, is the fact that there is not an organized government standing in front of the Holocaust trying to prevent its propagation, knowledge of it from being propagated. If the German government had taken a different stance, if it had been allowed to take a different stance, it certainly was not, but if it had been allowed to take a different stance and to say, these Jews were really very untrustworthy, they were plotting for a world conspiracy to take over the world, you know all the stories, take over the world, they were eating at the roots of our nation, and in any case, not many of them died compared with the number of Germans who were killed in World War II, there were far fewer Jews than Germans who died, so what's all this business about genocide, what's all this business about Holocaust? If that German government went further, and if it were able to turn it into a military importance of saying, now I talk about the Federal Republic of Germany, if the Federal Republic of Germany in the West said, look, we are a NATO ally, you have military bases in our country, if you value our alliance, and if you value the military bases in our country, you will not make an issue of this Jewish problem. In because it's exaggerated and so forth. In these circumstances, this very favorable attitude, and I shouldn't take the word very favorable, because it's not very favorable, but mildly favorable attitude where this kind of Holocaust studies can even be accepted by our administration, will probably not exist. In the case of the Armenians, each time that they have tried to produce a Hollywood film, and there haven't been a lot of times, that's one of their problems, but that each time they have tried, it has been successfully aborted. Successfully aborted by foreign protests and our own government's intercession to not to, with film producers and others, in order not to create an unfavorable situation that might reflect upon American foreign policy and American foreign policy interests abroad. Now, these are very, this is a very fundamental difference in the response to genocide. It is, on the one case in the Holocaust, the acceptance of the Holocaust by the successive governments, no attempt by the German government, to my knowledge, there may be, but I'm not aware of it, to prevent conferences such as that went on today from taking place, discussion of the Armenian, or the Holocaust from taking place, movies on the Holocaust. Indeed, in Germany, we know there are a number of monuments erected to the victims of the Holocaust. There are discussions among German scholars about the Holocaust. In the school books, children are taken to the death camps to see what Nazism did and as their fellow Germans have done. This is almost a fantasy in the Armenian case. It has not happened. I don't know if it ever will happen. It's just a very different circumstance in which, instead of learning from the past, admitting that governments have done wrong, and trying to rectify the situation, there's the opposite of taking a very defensive attitude and a fortress mentality, that we are a fortress, we're being attacked by the world that doesn't understand us, that has persecuted us in its every way of its mental and its outlook toward us, and we're going to resist. In this circumstance, also the whole question of morality comes forward, because now we're dealing with the questions of judgment and honesty that the Facing History program wants to deal with. To what degree can we excuse intellectuals, academics, historians, and political scientists for taking a simply statist view, the view of their state, a state-sponsored view of history? We know that history has been written largely by the winners, the victors in history. The people who are defeated rarely have a history. It is the victory, the history of those who have succeeded. It's the history of manifest destiny, and it's the history of many other things in this country, or in other, and other countries. So the issue is, to what degree can we ourselves in this country, as academics, as students, as intellectuals, as teachers, simply take what the administration tells us, whether it's this administration or anything else, and accept it as the gospel truth and propagate it as the gospel truth without inquiry? This is a serious matter that is now facing the Armenian genocide, because in Turkey today, there is service to the state point of view. The entire academic community in Turkey has been mobilized to produce denial literature of the genocide. And in my office at UCLA, I receive probably at least once a month, and more likely twice a month, a new publication of denial. Of denial, and of making the victims actually the perpetrators of the crime. The ultimate final stage, Reverend Artunian would say, the final stage is the denial of the genocide, and a part of that denial is making the victims themselves the perpetrators. The Jews did it. They brought it about themselves. They were going to do this. The Armenians did it. They were disloyal, and so on and so forth. And that is a problem that we are today facing. On the more positive side, in this country, there is an increasing awareness of the Holocaust, and particularly in the field of education, there is more attention being paid to human rights issues and to the issues of how to prevent mass killing and how to prevent genocide. This century, of course, is loaded with mass killings, and they're still taking place. The Holocaust was not the end. You know that 2 or 3 million Kampucheans or Cambodians were victimized by their own government. It was a turning upon itself. You know that even today, as we speak here, in areas such as Sri Lanka, formerly Ceylon, or Uganda, the threat of genocide is present right now. But with this, we have seen in the last few years, states such as New York State, New Jersey State, Connecticut State, California this year, now mandating that students should have as a part of their curriculum, a unit, at least a unit, or a course on the issues of human rights, including the crime of genocide. This opens great new vistas for educators. It opens whole new vistas for those of us who are interested in this subject. But once again, we're going to find the same problems that we have found individually. Mr. Parsons told you that the advice is don't get into controversial areas. And I have seen in school administrators this very issue. We don't want any problems. We don't want any parents coming in and protesting. We don't want any ethnic group coming in and protesting. That makes us very nervous. So let's back off from controversial issues. Now, for the Holocaust, it is okay to dismiss the radical anti-Semites who propagate the hate literature and create this Institute of Historical Research which denies the genocide, because more or less all school administrators, or nearly all school administrators and teachers, dismiss these people as freakies. Dangerous, but they're not mainstream. They are extreme. But that's not, once again, it's not true in the Armenian case. The Armenian genocide took place 30 years before. There is a community and a government which denies it. Now, what do you do when that government now starts sending you the literature of denial, hundreds and hundreds of articles and books, which for someone who has not studied the subject confuses them? You become confused by seeing all of this. Well, the American game is a game of fair play, isn't it? The truth probably is somewhere in the middle, says the American. There's always two sides to every question. And if there are two sides to every question, and A says this, and B says this, then the truth probably is somewhere at 40 degrees or 60 degrees angle. And it's very hard for many of us as Americans, as teachers, as educators, to really come down and have the commitment to say the truth happens to be 98% here and 2% there, or 100% there and 0% here. These are the issues that as teachers, we are going to have to face as we look toward the questions of the development of these curricula in which literally millions of up and coming generations of American children will become aware of what happened. Let us not forget that it will soon be the 21st century. We're only a decade and a half away, or less than a decade and a half in the 21st century. It's going to be very easy for the deniers, or those who wish to deny, in just about 12 or 13 years to say, Armenian genocide? Ancient history. Holocaust? Ancient history. As you know, our memories are short. A whole century ago, and I think back in my own youth, looking back on the 19th century, that was a long, long time ago, it seemed to me, and yet these issues of morality and judgment will remain with us, and we hope we can deal with them. This book, Facing History in Ourselves textbook, as I said, is a textbook of some 400 pages. It has a chapter of 60, 70 pages on the Armenian genocide. It's broken down into readings in which, and the whole book is done that way, by the way. The whole book deals with readings. You get perhaps in a chapter. I think since most of you haven't read the book, we have the titles of the chapters are Society and the Individual, Anti-Semitism, A Case Study of Prejudice and Discrimination, German History, World War I to World War II, Nazi Philosophy and Policy, Preparing for Obedience, Victims of Tyranny, the Holocaust, Who Knew, Questions of Judgment, and interestingly enough, the Armenian Genocide comes at the end of the book, the chapter. Now that, for many teachers who like chronology, is troublesome. Because here we're dealing with World War II, we're dealing with the Holocaust, and suddenly we get to the end of the book, and we've gone back 30 years more to World War I and the Armenian Genocide, and we all like things in a chronological order. So a lot of teachers get nervous with that and want to bring the Armenian Genocide forward. One could make an issue of any way. On the other hand, I think the intention of the authors was to deal with the Holocaust and all the issues with it, and then take those set of as the understanding is developed, because the understanding of the Holocaust takes about 7 or 8 chapters here, and then try to apply those set of principles to the Armenian case. So that there are readings that the student does, and then questions and issues that are raised for the student to think about. And thinking is the name of this curriculum. It is intended to make the students individually and collectively think. Think about the issues that are being raised, and not simply giving them, spoon-feeding them, or everything you want them to know. They have to come to their own conclusions. And obviously you give them some direction, and you hope that they're going to come to the kinds of conclusions you want them to come to, but you do that in a subtle way, and you do it by giving them a variety of views and a variety of readings and having them discuss it. And the questions are, as we look at this, this is not the final Bible. Obviously, it's a good book now. It can become better. It will be revised. It has to be changed as new literature comes forward and so forth. And I'm sure that the authors themselves are aware of that. And some of the issues that we... has anyone used this cooking teaching? 1, 2, 3, 4? Okay. Some of the issues that we have to raise, and I now speak specifically of the Armenian side of it, is, as I read this 70 pages, the first time I read it, I shook my head and told Bill Parsons, you've just packed in too much here. How is anyone ever going to understand this very complex history of the Armenians, their whole history and so forth? How is a seventh grade child, as he said, in South Boston, going to understand who are these people, what is the whole issue, what was the problem of Armenians living in the Ottoman Empire, what is meant by second-class citizenship, why was there some Armenian resistance, what was it that the Armenians wanted, why did genocide take place? All of these things are being thrown at seventh-grade children. And then I even went beyond that and I asked myself, what teachers can deal with all of this issue? Because there is a, most American teachers know nothing or very little about Armenians. This indeed may inspire them or force them to read more about Armenians, to get some background about Armenians, to bring it into the classroom. And as we look at this, therefore, one of the questions that has to be asked is there enough background, or are there ways in which we can provide teachers and students with the auxiliary materials to make this chapter or subsequent chapters that will be written all the more meaningful for them? There are certain other areas which I feel are vital. Holocaust media is very rich. We have the film, the footage of the death camps. There are the footage of the victims of the Holocaust. There is footage of the SS. There are footage. There are the films of all kinds. There are, that is, the Nazis were very good record keepers. They recorded their own murder. They celebrated genocide. And it's been said that genocide is a celebration of death. And in, therefore, they commemorated the celebration of death by photographing what was going on. In the Armenian case, there's much less. I mean, imagine, if you will, 1915, the deserts of Syria and Anatolia. Who was going to go running around with cameras taking photographs? No one was much interested in doing that. The Turks were not that much interested in that much advanced technologically that they would want to go around and photograph the thing. Once again, it seems to be that it was a German officers in Turkey. If there's much photography, and there isn't much, but the little that does exist seems to have been taken by German officers, and in particular Armin Wegner, who was a Red Cross officer in the German army and who took photos of the death camps of the Armenians, and some of these photos have remained. But the important point is that there is lacking the audiovisual component for teaching. There are a couple of films. Michael Hagopian in California made a film, The Forgotten Genocide, but that's now 10 years old. And it was done, it was one film, but there should be many kinds of films. There should be audiovisual clips. Oral history has now come into its own, the videotaping of the survivors and making a story from this. And I would say that to those of you who would represent Armenian organizations, and I don't think there are many of you here today, but the whole emphasis on audiovisual is very important. The development of curriculum aids. And finally, the development of documentation. Documentation has been the latest sort of, craze is not the word, but the fad, documentation among Armenian organizations. Everybody suddenly, in the last 2 years, has decided they're going to document the Armenian genocide. No one thought about it for 60, 70 years, and suddenly everyone is thinking about it. Nasser has just announced that it's going to organize an Institute for Genocide Studies with a $25,000 grant. I don't know what they can do with $25,000. The Zorian Institute has talked about a documentation project. The Armenian Assembly has talked for years now about a documentation project. The Turkeyan Institute of Montreal is talking about a center of documentation. In Dearborn, Michigan, the Knights of Artan have given $100,000 to that university, the income from which should be used. What is the income from $100,000? I suppose it's $8,000 or $9,000 to be used for documentation. I mean, here we have a strange proliferation of five different organizations talking about that they're going to be, they're cutting out turf that this is going to be mine. It's the wrong approach, if you ask me. They better get together and find out what that turf is and what the project is and who should be doing what, rather than everyone jumping in into the sea. Now, that's an internal Armenian matter that shouldn't have to concern you, but the Jews have the same problem. The issues of turf become very important. And if you, to non-Jews, it seems that there's a great deal of unity and great deal of strength within the organizations, but those of you who come from Jewish organizations know that internally there's a great deal of conflict, of tension, and matters of turf. We're in California, this is ours, don't come here. We're in Boston, this is mine, I stake out my claim here. We don't want your other organizations coming here. And sometimes the work in itself is damaged, does not go forward with the speed and with the precision and the coordination is necessary. So I guess one of the things that I'm speaking and wrapping with you with about those of you who represent any of the organizations that I just mentioned is that I think that if you're going to stake out a claim such as a serious claim of documentation or genocide institute, don't take those claims lightly. Those are very serious and they should require both a great deal of money, certainly coordination and work within the community and within the organizations of the community. Well, facing history is, from the Armenian point of view now, the best thing that ever happened, from the point of view of education. I can't speak about the Holocaust with such authority. That is, there are many curriculums dealing with the Holocaust. There would be some, I'm sure, who would say this is the very and the best, but there may be others who say that it's not the best. But I will tell you that it's the best for the Armenians because it's the only one that has seriously addressed the issue of genocide and the Armenian experience. It's the only one that has accepted some, has received some acceptability within the school systems. There are problems. I see a lot of problems. That is, most teachers in most schools simply don't have a semester to spend on this book. Most of them perhaps want to spend 2 weeks. And when you have 2 weeks, what is it you do and what is you leave out? It's quite possible to leave out the whole Armenian chapter, one assumes, and teach Holocaust. Although, in the very first lines, I think it's worth I read the first paragraph. It says, "The obstacles to learning about genocide as it was first practiced in the 20th century upon the Ottoman Armenians and its ultimate expression in the Holocaust are great. It is not yet considered a serious subject for social scientists, nor is it covered by teachers or included in textbooks. This is now changing somewhat. Then it goes on and says, after these two events, although these two events are from distinctly different times and places, with particular victims and unique outcomes, with unique precedents and antecedents, practiced by different nations and their citizens with different intensity, they have shared a common fate. Both of these events have been ignored, avoided, or denied, and if treated, revived beyond recognition. Since most events of the 20th century have elicited intense scholarly investigation and reportage, this silence is particularly disturbing, and so forth. So that the authors let you know from page one that they want to deal with two issues. What we need to do, I think, is to see that the study of human rights and the prevention of genocide becomes serious enough within our school districts that they're willing to spend a full unit, an 8-week period, a 16-week period, with this text and other materials as a very important learning. And as I said, it not only deals with past instances of mass murder, but it also deals with someone sitting down next to a person of different skin, of different faith, of different culture, and being able to relate to that person and to respect that person. That, after all, is, I think, the learning that has to come from this. With these introductory comments, I would like to see. Thank you. I think it might be now instructional if Mr. Parsons, who is the co-author of this book and the associate of the Case in History and ourselves, would continue the program. Are you going to do an introduction with this Hangman film? First, get me off the Hangman. There is an issue of TERF. The question is, in the California curriculum, can we use what's here? It's funny, you know, curriculum writers are threatened by already established curriculum because they're going to be put out of business. I'm exaggerating a bit. No, this will certainly be submitted along with other kinds of materials to the Californians, but there is an issue. There are images of TERF that exist there. But in California, the state is mandated. They have now appointed committees, a writing committee, advisory committee, and review committees for the preparation of it. Now, the problem, of course, is deadline. This is supposed to be ready in 3 months' time, and they haven't even started for the curriculum. So I doubt that they will be ready for implementation in time, but it will go forward. Yes? Of which book? Of Facing History? This is one of the authors in front of us. His background is he's the son of a Baptist. Is he Baptist? Do you admit it? All right, Baptist minister, and who has spent years as a teacher of human rights and in the classroom. And it's interesting, one of the things that I didn't say about Facing History is that, in a sense, it was not the Armenians who discovered Facing History. It was Facing History who discovered the Armenians. They came out and found and felt that this was an important component. Margot Sternstrom is the founding director. Is that correct, Bill? Or do you want to answer? I think maybe you should answer the question. Founding director in the Brookline schools, very much committed to this. The two of them together prepared this text with input from many other people. Is that properly said? Where can you get the text? Is it being sold here? It's being sold outside. Is it here tonight? It's in the room. And otherwise, from the Facing History and Ourselves Foundation in Brookline, Massachusetts. It's listed in your phone book as the Facing History and Ourselves Foundation. Yes? Yes. Yes, I was. When I say the only one, I suppose I should have said the only one that I consider to be of strong value. The New York State curriculum I was involved in the preparation of that. But here we're dealing with, and also in Connecticut, they have the state curriculum, in which there are, in New York, perhaps 8 pages out of two volumes of several hundred pages, 8 pages dealing with the Armenians. And then, in a rather iffy fashion, saying that it looks like there was a genocide. The Armenians say there was a genocide, and they say this. But the Turks say there was not a genocide, and the Turks say this. And so there are two sides to the issue that are presented in the New York State curriculum. But, once again, as you put it on the scale, you see that it's probably better being there than not being there, because it brings forward, within, under the title of Holocaust and Genocide Studies, a few pages. They've taken a couple of maps from my books, reproduced them to show where Armenia was at a particular time, and then present excerpts from my or other person's writings, and then excerpts from a person, Justin McCarthy, who is a demographer and who feels that the Turkish point of view is worthy and has done a great deal of propagation of the Turkish point of view. So they're reading some of Justin McCarthy's works as well. So there are certainly pages in various curricula being developed, but we're having a much harder time probably. We're going to face a much harder time in the state develop curriculums when there is a government which protests, when an embassy, a cultural attaché, an educational attaché, picks up the telephone and says, look, I want to come down and see you people, this is all wrong, and so forth. Now, once again, unless you're committed to a view, and you know that this is the history of people, want to back off, and curriculum writers are going to back off. And this is one thing, of course, the case in history has not done. They've not backed off. They've been put under some pressure, not intense, but some pressure. But they say, look, we believe this history to be true. And we're not going to back off simply because there is a government that denies, because many people deny. How many murderers really admit readily? Not many. Yes? Well, the ways to deal with Turkish denial, of course, are numerous. First and foremost, a great deal of fresh scholarship has to be done, the documentation, searching, writing. The Armenians have waited too long to do this kind of writing. They felt that the world was so much aware of the Armenian genocide, every newspaper in the world screamed headlines about the genocide, that it never occurred to them in the 1920s or 1930s that they would have to prove that it occurred. Now, it's 60 years later, the survivor generation has vanished, and all of you who are Armenian, your mothers or your fathers who survived, every one of them had a story. Some of them didn't talk about it very often, but others of them told you all the time, and you lived your parents' deportation route. That's not true now, and it requires serious work. Now, the issue of denial is political, obviously. That is, simply by the production of scholarly works, it doesn't mean the denial will end, because denial is politically motivated. And as long as power politics rule the world, you can't hope that it's going to have much impact upon governments necessarily, but it should have an impact upon the public, the educational community, and so forth. And I would therefore see that one of the priorities for Armenian studies is to do what the Holocaust scholars have done, and that is to make this a serious area of research. It has not been a serious area of research. There are not 5 individuals in this whole country, if this world, who are dealing specifically and only with this subject. And I find it ironic and also gratifying that it's Jewish scholars who are taking the lead now in studying the Armenian genocide. Yes? It is divisive. It is divisive. I mean, the issue that the dialogue that goes on between these people, it is divisive, but I'm not saying necessarily bad. It divides them into different camps of people. For example, there would be very
firm believers in the uniqueness, and these largely are survivors themselves, would have difficulty participating in a forum in which the Armenian genocide or the Cambodian genocide was going to be on the same common program. But at the same time, even those individuals who have that difficulty do want to say and do state that out of their unique experience can be drawn universal lessons. I think that's how they try to deal with that. Yes. I would say no. Not really historically. It's a perspective. The Armenians were still living in their homeland. This was the land of Armenia. It had been conquered by the Turks. There was a fear of the Turks that the Armenians would want to do what the rest of the Christians had done, and that is to detach their lands and create a separate Armenia. And there were many Armenians who wanted autonomy, self-government, independence. So there's an issue of nationalism here, national identity. Now, Jewish scholars who would stress uniqueness would say, look, Jews were not living in Israel. There was no Israel. They were living in a diaspora. They were no threat to the government. But I can turn right around and say, who says they were not a threat to the government? If you look at what many Nazis said, and may have believed, they were a threat not only to the government, but to the world, because there was a conspiracy to take over the world by these people, the rich bankers and so forth. So one can take, I think, both sides of the argument. I have to respect both of them. But what I am finding is that younger Jewish scholars are moving away. I mean, they pay lip service to the uniqueness. That is a uniqueness. But they're saying that, look, we have to find the message in all of this, and have an understanding. And even if it is unique, to be sure that's unique by studying other Holocausts and genocides in order to be able to do the comparison, the comparative approach to it.
I think it's far more important, regardless of where you are on the issue of both religion and religion, to look at the tension between them. And if you want that discussion going on in the classroom, you want kids in class having this kind of dialogue with this person. Okay? That's what you want. You see, the alternative is you get the Chicago program. The Chicago program is called Man's and Humanity's Demand. It's got two or three pages on everything, from Tunisia to Cambodia to Vietnam to the genocide to the Holocaust to black slavery to the Zulus to on and on and on. It's a great equalizer. In other words, what you present with kids on that kind of version of education is a little bit on everything and nothing on anything. And history isn't all like that. In fact, what you can find out when we found out from kids in Chicago who were taking the course, that particular course, was that there were kids who were almost saying, there was almost this hopelessness at the end of the course. It's almost like, so give me another example. So give me another example. But so what? So I've seen worse on Halloween 3 or the filmmaker. So give me another example. So go ahead, pile up. And what happens is you never get a critical thinking. If you never look at any event with any kind of depth, you never push kids to have any educational jargon, disequilibrium. You never get, because they make simple parallels. They simply say, see, they're all the same. They all happen in time of war. They all have a war. So they make all these simple parallels and they simply go on. And so there's no struggle, and it's not even, I think the other key issue is that there's very little work in this country in terms of dealing with teachers in terms of rationale questions. When I just came back from the Los Angeles workshop a couple weeks ago, the statement in terms of evaluation from teachers was finally a program had come along that wasn't trying to indoctrinate. That's significant, because what you're allowing teachers to do is to think about the rationale questions, which are far more important than ever getting to even the content. It really is. Because what you do is you need teachers to be asking questions. Why teach about the Armenian genocide? Why teach that piece of history? Why not choose something more recent? Why not deal with Cambodia? Why not just deal with the Holocaust? And why go back and look at the Armenian genocide? So what we do is we spend a great deal of time talking to teachers back and forth, the kind of discussion that we could have opened it up here, in terms of why teach about this piece of history. And one of the profound pieces is that, you know, Richard talked about why we, you know, that we put at the end of the book. It's one of the controversies. And teachers, it's a resource book. Teachers use it. Teachers spread it throughout their courses. Some teachers teach World War I, teach it there. Other teachers, when they're talking about Jim Crow law in this country and the black slavery, those teachers often take the discriminatory law in the Ottoman Empire. Or then they leap ahead and they do it sort of thematically or whatever. What we're more interested in is that people start seeing that this kind of material is important material that students can start to be dealing with, and not in a simplistic way. We're trying to encourage kids not to be content with simple answers, which so many as adults want to do at the workshop.
Let me say that that's true. The whole issue once again of universality and uniqueness brings us down to the question of what is genocide. That is, there is not agreement. Definitions of genocide. I gave you a very broad definition of genocide that in the United Nations Charter. Some people would say the dropping of the bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki was genocide. There are many others who say no, that was not genocide. It was an act of law that was mass killing. It was mass killing, but not genocide, because it was not intended to wipe out a people. But if you take the UN definition, it's wiping out a people in part, and therefore it might be qualified as genocide. I found it interesting that Yehuda Bauer, who's a very well-known Holocaust historian, and who went around this country and lecturing on the uniqueness of the Holocaust, after having studied this further, having talked to me, heard a few of my lectures, and then investigating it, said, you're right. These two examples, the Armenian and the Jewish, from this is the point of view of a uniquest, the person from a unique perspective, these two are the closest possible of two genocides with the same ingredients that go into them. And if I were to give you a lecture on the Armenian genocide, I could compare each step and each ingredient that went into each of the two. And it's not to mean, it is not to detract from it. That's the other last point that I will make. I think Barbara Mgurian has one question, but the last point that I'd like to make is, those people who have suffered genocide are not necessarily sympathetic to other people who suffer mass tragedy or killing. Armenians who are survivors do not necessarily extend their sentiment to Cambodians. Holocaust survivors do not necessarily extend this sentiment to Armenians or anyone else. It's that sense of bitterness that they have endured, that suffering they have endured, that they believe that no one in the world could have suffered what they have suffered or seen what they have seen. And that is, again, one of the aims, I suppose, of a group of a program such as Facing History, is to draw these people. I mean, who better than a Jew and an Armenian to be able to discuss man's inhumanities in that? I mean, these are natural combinations, and yet there's very minimal contact and communication, collaboration between these groups. It's an interesting thing. Barbara, do you have a question? Or is it finished? There are different points of view. I don't have yet enough experience to talk about that. There's not enough of a track record. Facing History people would say it's better to do it in a voluntary way, to make it the teachers want to have it, and to sell it to them as a good product, rather than dictating to them that you have to do it. So that's the Facing History. On the other hand, there are a lot of school districts that will never do it in the world forever unless there is a mandate. It's not the mandating, it's how then you go and produce the curriculum. That's the key area. I think that mandating the teaching of human rights and genocide in California is a good thing. I don't know if the final result is going to be a good thing, because that requires a great deal of work, and certainly more work than is allowed. They're supposed to come up with a curriculum in June of 86. We're in April, and they haven't even met yet. Curriculum writer. So that, you know, that's more a serious issue, I think. Oh, yeah. Well, do that, but let's do it shortly. I don't think we want to get involved in this. It was, I think the issue is one that debate will go on for a long time, not only in this hall, but in many halls. But would you? Well, it's let me just, Reverend, let me just respond to you, and that is to speak only in terms of the Armenian genocide. There are different interpretations of the Armenian genocide by Armenians themselves. There are, you obviously know there are Armenians who say that we were called upon to witness for Christ, right? I mean, this was a privilege. There are those who would say that it was a privilege to witness as Christ sacrificed his life, the Armenians sacrificed theirs. The others who would blame, would go into self-hatred and say, we must have done something wrong for this to have happened. And that concept of sacrifice is in the very word Holocaust. I mean, the Holocaust is the sacrifice of a people. I mean, I think it was a mischosen word for what happened, because it really wasn't, and the Armenians used the word also martyr. But martyrs do it willingly. Neither the Armenians nor the Jews went willingly to the death. They went unwillingly to their death. And so they're neither martyrs nor the Holocaust. They were victims. They were victims of murder, but the terms have come, they stick, and so forth. I think the point that I'm making is that, while I understand your sensitivities, and I think that you're right in that certainly Holocaust scholars have to be aware of the larger issues, and I think the better scholars are certainly aware of that. Nonetheless, we can never expect that there's going to be absolute conformity on any dimension. I think I've overstayed my, well, in the back, yes, John. Certainly one means of remembering, indeed. Yes. Unfortunately, I don't think the Armenian organizations are well enough organized that they can really claim turf and put their foot on it, their feet on it. When you say, let me not leave you with a misinterpretation. The Armenian organizations that I mentioned are not at war with one another. They're not hostile to one another. But they're each now come to a place where all of them are thinking about the same thing at the same time. And I am suggesting that it's to be effective, they either have to come together and decide what their turf is and who should do what and so forth. And I'm also suggesting that you're not going to do a serious study with $10,000 or $20,000 or $100,000. These are multi-million dollar operations if you're going to do the job properly, going into every archive of the world, around the world, such as Jewish scholars of it. You have Yad Vashem as you know, in Jerusalem has an archive that it bewilders you. In very near future, there will be a Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., with an educational component in which you're going to be able to go in and push the word Vilnius or Vilna, and you're going to say synagogues. They will be able to recreate for you on film immediately the synagogue, the history of each synagogue, and so on and so forth. That is, the computer age has arrived. You can do anything. You could, and this is what the Armenians have to do, but they have to get the resources to do it, to go and push the word Kharkiv or Vram, and then have the statistics, this many people, this many churches, these are the schools, and then you do subdivision under churches, and they'll come out with the names of the churches, or under the schools. But there's just enormous material that can be fed into the computers for the educational component. And while none of these organizations that I mentioned has yet really gone very far, they all have making claims, and I read in the newspaper with some amazement every couple of months that another organization is deciding that it's going to do Holocaust or genocide or documentation. These are all very timely and have to be done. I just think that we'd better coordinate ourselves. So I think we want to see a film. We don't want to run on too long. Anthony Hangman, you want to do an introduction to it? Thank you. I'm finished.